Thank you all for staying up until now. I will be presenting Mesos, Apache Mesos. It's an open source project. And it targets mostly infrastructure as a service, and it allows you to build, let's say, the layer of your hybrid cloud. So really a few things for me. The official name you see in the calendar is Nikolaos. I know it's Greek, it's difficult. You can call me Nick. I love scuba diving and computers. That's why we're all here. And how many of you have experience with cloud infrastructures? In the level of I'm using AWS, I'm running my hybrid cloud. Perfect. So you know better than me that you have faced all these things that you remember in the university, but they tend to appear over and over, and what is the Byzantine agreement, when actually the nodes, they will decide in between them who is the master, what happens if the master goes out, and if you put all these things together, they form your hybrid cloud. We call it nowadays cloud. Actually, it's a big distributed system, in essence, and it's a little bit rebranded to look better and to be sold even better. So we've reached to the era of the cloud, but we have to think a little bit why we need to make the move. I mean, how the data centers in the past used to look and where the problem was lying. So also, I believe many of you have run software projects, right? I mean, in the old traditional way of we have our static data center, and then you were reaching the point that your manager would ask you, can you size the infrastructure in where the project will run? And then you had like where the wind blows effect. He will tell you, can you tell me what I need to reserve for you? And you couldn't give him like an absolute answer. You would say like, I will do an estimation. And most of the times the estimation was of the kind like, these are the loads I will have. I will do that 110% more, and that's what I will tell him. And actually then what happens most of the times is that you need to do an upgrade, and you can bring half of your infrastructure down, but still the service is up. So apparently you did something wrong there. And people start questioning, was that an initial good estimation? And there where things start to become strange. And there is where this new era kicks in. So a typical problem, and we can vote on that. Like, it's easy to scale out, right? I think we all agree on that. Even back in the 80s, if you want to run your proprietary image processing thing, you would go to CGI and you'd say, I need this vector machine. And CGI would tell you, if you have to give me 10 million, I can give it to you. And then 2 years pass and you need half of the racks there. What do you do with that? And there is where actually the oversizing and underutilization of the committed hardware is increasing the cost, and that's really evident to people that are hiring the management. So we come to the new era where we have elasticity and all this nice feature of infrastructure as a service, and we can actually scale up and scale down, which the most important part is actually the scaling down of our infrastructure, which implies that we need to be able to understand that now our application does not need all the resources, and the resources can be given back to the system. So we come into this new era of how data centers look like. And most of them are based on open source technologies. There are people coming from vendor-like implementation that are really big and they start to come into play, but most of the solutions are based on open source projects. And you no longer have this monolithic view on your infrastructure. So you look at your infrastructure as a whole of pool of resources that you can utilize in order to deploy stuff. This has a consequence that you need to categorize what your resources are. So like deploying a traditional web app in a hybrid cloud is a different workload than what you would have if you want to deploy something that does MapReduce because you want to run analytics in a big data infrastructure. So we go back to what reactive is. And have you been in the early let's say presentations in the morning where it was all about reactiveness? And reactiveness is very nice because it gives us this very nice capability of being able to scale up and down. And actually, it's difficult. It's not as simple as it is presented. And how many of you had these epic failures of trying to downsize your infrastructure? Like, yes, we think it will work, but then someone calls, no, the services are down, and all the hell breaks loose. And then you have a new set of problems that comes into play, and that is, where are my services? What service discovery is? And how I can recover the services? And how can I recover the resources I had? If you put all this into play, yes, it's very fancy, it's very nice, it's really dynamic, it's cutting edge, but it's really difficult, it's extremely difficult. And then we have Docker. That's a new elephant in the room where people start asking, okay, and what is happening with this beast? And it's very nice because everyone is doing it and you're doing microservices with that. And you have people saying, yes, I'm deploying my three-tier application, which is a typical web app in Docker. I'm doing microservices. And then maybe your DevOps guy is laughing at you. And how many of you believe that Docker is a new technology? No answer? It's too intimidating question. You know, you all know the answer?
It's a tricky question.
Yes. So what Docker bring in the now that we didn't have in the past and we are using these containers? So actually, I will answer that as none of you is willing to help me with that. Is that in the past, actually, the only API binding to Linux containers was something that was based in C. And you didn't have this nice feature of layering. So you had to write enormous code to do Linux containers. But, for example, Google is running their entire infrastructure 20 years now using LXC. So it's not something new. It is only became really, it becomes a commodity to the developer. You can run your Docker thing, and it will spawn up these very nice containers where you can deploy, or you can deliver the container as a deployable unit. Again, it's difficult. People tend to believe that if they do Docker containers, they do microservices, another fallacy. It's not easy, it's difficult, and it's really hard to maintain. Why? The maturity of the tools when it comes to the average DevOps sysadmin guy is not what you would have in the traditional world. So what I mean by that, if I compare the console, for example, a famous project for managing containers Kubernetes has to what the ECSX from VMware has, I mean, the skills that you expect from your DevOps guy, it's in a totally different scale. So we come now to the era of understanding that we need actually a distributed system kernel, something that actually we deploy it in our cluster and it sees, exposes our cluster like as a pool of resources. Okay. One of these projects, and it was the initial project that was actually embracing Docker as a container technology to run on your pool of resources in the cloud, it is Apache Mesos. It is based on C groups, of course, in order to isolate your resources, because underlying it uses containers. Okay, it's cloud-ready and cloud-friendly. It can be deployed in your own local in-house data center, and then that thing can be expanded to all the known players in the cloud, something like AWS, Google Cloud, anything you name, you can use it. Okay, it's like this, the heart, the beating heart of what it is called DCOS, and it's sold by, again, Mesosphere. I'm white-labeled, as you see in the presentation. I'm not advertising any of these people. I'm telling you what it is available, and it's for free. So what assembles a Mesos cluster? We have actually two different entities there. First of all, we need Zookeeper, okay, who is the orchestrator of who is the master and who is alive. It does the orchestration, as you can see in the presentation. So we have the Mesos master, who are the people responsible for understanding and pulling from the small people called agents, the resources that are available or the resources that these agents are advertising as pullable resources to execute payloads. And more or less what this thing does it is allows you to see the resources of your, let's say, if these are VMs, as a holistic view. So you don't see that I have one VM that has two CPUs, another VM that has two CPUs. You only see that you have a pool of four CPUs from which you can deploy things, and then you have this pool of memory. So what it can do, as we said, it can do really nice hybrid clouds. It allows linear scalability. It has the notion of frameworks, so you can extend it, actually, and it offers an API, a very nice API for extending it, or even writing your own containers or executors, as we call them. And of course, it can run traditional workloads that you pack them in containers, or traditional microservices solutions. There is actually where it shines, because it has a big ecosystem on how you then you interconnect with microservices, how you do service discovery, and so forth. And time flies. So we'll do some developing. I've prepared a small cluster just to showcase what happens with the resources and how they are populated back and forth to the small Apache Mesos cluster. All of these things will be available in GitHub. In my GitHub, I will have a Vagrant file that will allow you to bootstrap all these VMs, so that you don't need to go through all the pain of configuration. So here we are. So as you can see here, I have two Mesos master nodes running and two Mesos clients running. Of course, I will dig up my browser, who is not there yet. So yes, they may have slept. Okay, let's wake them up. Very nice. How you can manually do that, or there are chef books and things like that. At the end of the presentation, I have several resources that you can dig up and even set up a small virtual box with the configuration I have. Okay. Exactly. Just to clarify, you need some basic Linux skills. Even though on the site you will listen that, yes, it can work in all operating systems, it's POSIX compliant, don't fight the fight of trying to run it in Windows. It will, I will not say never. If you manage to do it, I'm here and I'm open to suggestions, but my experience is that it doesn't work. Okay. And believe me, I've spent way too much time trying to make it work. So yes, here, as you can see, actually, this is the Mesos management console, and that's why I was referring back to. It is a kind of console to see what is happening, and as you can see here, it tells me that I have a master. This is the leader IP listening to this port. Information about the system that it is run, and there I can see the agents, the tasks, and actually the resources. Okay, again, here you can see that it's an active configuration. So this is the other node. If I decide to shut down one, then automatically Zookeeper kicks in and tells me like there is another node that now is the master, and so forth. I do it with two. In production environment, you should do it at least with five. Three is not an option to me. I mean, if you go to Zookeeper, the quorum, they say the minimum should be three, but this would imply that if one fails, then you have a segmentation in your cluster and it will never work. So go 5 to 7 so that you have area of reaction, or you have the capability of reacting. And now what we will do is we will go to our clients. Okay, so these are two VMs, and here, as you will see, No. I want my history. It's not here, it's here. Yes. So here I'm telling him that he needs, of course, this can be a service. And I'm telling him, of course, that you need to dig the master from the zookeeper under this class, under this path, okay? And some configurations I'm passing to him, like what is the IP to be advertised and so forth. And now if I refresh my zookeeper, my mesos, you will see that it tells me I have two CPUs available and I have 1,000 megabytes of RAM and the disk that I have committed to that. All these things right down here, I don't know if you can see them clearly. Exactly. So all these things are configurable through cgroups configurations. Okay? So now let's go back and we go to our other client. Again, we do more or less the same launch. And now, if I wait a bit, it will refresh itself, but there's no point. As you can see, actually, now I have four CPUs, and I have 2 gigabytes of RAM, and actually the disk size changed. So now let's bring down the slave. Also, you can get information, a lot of information about the state of the cluster. If you go here, you can see the machines, and you can see what you are executing actually on them. So now let's bring down a node. Okay, and see what happens. So here initially you would say, but the guy says that I have still 4, which is wrong because I haven't configured the TTL in order that guy will send back the resources that he knew he had, and he will ask the agent, I'm still committing from your side these resources. So it will take, I think it's around 1 minute, where this guy will change the status here and it will go from 4 to 2. So it is a project that it's very simplistic in the terms of what you can do with it. Bear in mind that that's the way Apache Spark suggests that you should use if you want to have distributed Spark. It can run Kubernetes. It can run several other projects, like you can run schedulers on top of it. And to give you a better overview of what can be built on top of it, this is a product, okay, that actually is based on Mesosphere. I'm bringing up again and again the name of Mesosphere. Why? It was the first company that was supporting actually the project. Most of the open source community guys actually who work and commit to the Apache Mesos are employees of Mesosphere. And here you will get a better overview of actually what you can do or what you can install on it. So it can be I can start my Docker container that runs MySQL, anything. An important thing that we passed really fast in the previous thing here. Thank you. Yes, let's go step forwards, is the containerizers. So actually, containerizers is an API Mesos is offering for you to interact with the what they call executor. It is an API. By default, it supports the Mesos executor and the Docker executor. It offers a very nice Java API, a Python API, and if I'm not mistaken, a Go API. So if you want to do a custom thing, like I want to execute a custom fat jar, like if you were previously, or if you heard Josh speaking about that, you can create your custom executor here and invoke a fat jar. Okay? So, moving on, 6 minutes, okay. So, starting from here, this is where you will find most of the information available on the internet. It is a fairly new open source project. There is a lot of need for commitment from the community. We are looking for committers and people who are interested in working on it. It's written in C++, so you might need to go a little bit back to the old stuff. And thank you very much for your time. We can now have a session on Q&A if you want, or if you have any questions. Thank you. So you were thrilled about it, and now you are opening your Macs to run the VMs, right? Not? Yes.
So when we are, you can use the Docker containerization.
Yes.
On a Mesos platform, so the cluster that you built with your infrastructure that you demonstrated here, you could have a single container accessing the whole resources completely transparently without any application impact.
Exactly, nothing. And it becomes transparent to you. Why? There is a project, I didn't present it here, called Marathon. And in Marathon, it allows you, for example, to describe your application in a JSON format. And there you can say, the Marathon will send that to be executed to the Mesos framework. And then Mesos will look in this description and will say, OK, this is a Docker container. Do I have Docker in the machine? If yes, you can even pinpoint where is the registry where your Docker containers are living, pull it down, and start it. So it abstracts entirely this thing from you. Mesos came to existence, why? Because in the past there was no solution for Docker cluster management. I mean, when that thing was developed, Swarm was not there. Okay, so you wanted a way to cluster your containers and being able to detect if something goes wrong so that you can move it, you can have... It has very nice capabilities, like I can partition my cluster and I say, I will start two instances of my application, but I want them always to be in a different rack. And this, even if one of my nodes goes down, it will make sure that the next deployment that is available to happen, it will be in a rack but and not in the same rack, so that I actually have high availability. Okay. Again, something that... because I've had a discussion with a bank about that. It's not easy. And that's something that needs to be communicated a lot to higher management. Resources with these skills that actually can deliver something in productive still costs a lot. And most of the times, people that are trying to mimic that they can do it in a cheap way because it's open source, another strong or wrong obsession of about open source is, they end up failing. And they blame the solution when actually what they should be looking at is, did they have the necessary resources and the capability of their resources in order to deliver things properly?
And then if you scale down, it would be completely transparent?
Yes. That thing will die. And if it was consuming two CPUs, this automatically go to the pool. Yes. You can apply all this very nice Docker thing of having the data in a separate container. That thing is synchronized actively with your actual SAN or the drive. Yes. Or they have built, let's say, a layer of services on top of what Docker REST endpoints were offering. And they can still give you access to it. How many of you have configured containers by speaking to the API of Docker? For example, that's an interesting question. OK, let's roll back. How many of you know that Docker actually has a REST API? How many of you used it actually to configure the container like that? Not changing configuration? No? OK. So these guys, through a project called Marathon, they have created a very well API on top of that, so that in a simplistic way, you can interact with it. So I can assign, let's say, I can map drives, I can assign resources to it, and so forth. And you don't need to know all these pet peeves of the Docker REST API. We have 1 minute left. Our time is up. Thank you very much for staying that long and being here.